Oh boy. Where do we begin? What pop culture news is worth talking about that will still be relevant in how many weeks when we release this?
I honestly don't know.
In one, two, three, four, 5 weeks. We're 5 weeks out. Yeah, no, five
I don't.
weeks. 4 weeks? Six weeks?
The point is very unlikely.
Yes. So should we just dive into it then?
Yes.
I'm buzzing. I'm excited. Okay. Hello and welcome to episode three of It's Giving Camp. I'm Saffron.
And I'm Fabiola.
And today we are talking about Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Saffron's choice because she loves the show.
I love this show. I love this show. Okay.
You're going to be the one carrying this episode.
I have a little bit of a preamble. I feel like a little addendum I need to say while we talk before we talk in about the show, because this is a Joss Whedon created show. And in case you were living under a rock, in case you somehow don't know, Joss Whedon is a he's not a great guy. Let's just say that. There's multiple accounts from his ex-wife about his abuse. There's multiple actors that he's worked with in different productions have come forward and talked about his abuse on set. And honestly, it feels very racially and misogynistic coded. But so, he's not a great guy. What do we do with that? What do we do with that when watching this show that he's made? Well, I tend to go with the opinion when you're looking at media made by not great people is that you can't fully ignore how their beliefs might have influenced what they made, but you can still watch it, engage with it, and take away what you need from it. And especially in things like television, where there are multiple people who worked to make the story that it is. So Buffy is as much Marty Noxon and Jane Epstein,
Isn't it Espenson?
Jane Espenson's.
I only know her name because she also wrote for
Yes.
Battlestar
And Sarah Michelle Gellar is as much someone who created Buffy Summers. So there's a great New York Times article that actually our former professor, Jen Mikalski, was quoted in talking about how we can still engage with Buffy even after actors have come forward with talking about Joss Whedon's abuse. So we can link that article in the show notes. But basically, I think it's every person who has like an experience with Buffy that it's everyone's gonna have a different opinion. And if this episode or watching this show is not something that you want to do, totally respect that and understand that. But I still go crazy over these guys. My Buffy was one of my mom's favorite shows. She showed it to me when we kind of first started watching television together. So it has very like personal significance to me. I watched it in high school when I was a similar age as Buffy. So it also really resonates with me for those reasons. Were there a lot of things in it? Are there a lot of things in it that are dated and bigoted even in the 90s when it was airing? Yes. but part of loving a piece of media is criticizing it. So with that all aside, Fabiola, what are your impressions of Buffy? I guess I'm asking because I'm curious.
So I've only watched at least like 5 episodes of Buffy and a few for like course stuff, and then another fewer for this episode. And so like basically what I knew about the show beforehand was that it was like, it's like this big cultural touchstone for television, and like female characters and like genre work as well.
Without me on this show and it being something that I love, would you have considered it as some like one of the things to talk about when talking about camp and television?
Possibly, because of the whole like genre, not just like the genre setting, but also like Buffy herself and like all the practical effects that are in the show.
Buffy gets described as campy often. Even in that New York Times article I mentioned, where it's talking about the how, you know, the kind of conversation around Joss Whedon in the show, it's still in its little summary of Buffy calls it, you know, smart and campy. Apparently Joss Whedon is quoted as saying that he hates it when people call Buffy camp, because, quote, "I don't enjoy dumb TV," which, sir, I think you're strongly misunderstanding what camp is, and also Buffy is camp. Like, the concept itself, Buffy the show is pitched as, you know, Joss Whedon said it's about taking the little blonde girl who goes into a dark alley and gets killed in every horror movie. The concept is subverting the horror movie genre, making this the kind of the damsel in distress the hero. And also, I mean, her name's Buffy.
Yeah, but it's also like not just about that subversion, but like the specific type of character that Buffy is. Like, she's like feminine and girly. Like, she's not the type of female character that tends to survive in genre stuff.
Yeah.
Or even be allowed to be like even likable or for people to even root for her.
Yeah, I mean, she's kind of a valley girl. You know, she was, you know, grew up in California, loved shopping, was a cheerleader before she became a slayer. When there's a lot of female characters in television who have like the strong female characters, many of them reject other women in their lives and kind of have not like other girl types. And Buffy is a character who throughout the series often distances herself, and is, you know, there's no one else like me, but it never has to do with her femininity. It has to do with her position as the slayer, the one, the chosen one. And she has her friends, and that is the theme that like goes throughout the show that makes her different than all the other slayers, is that she has her best friends with her and they help her and they grow along with her. And it's really a show about growing up. The other thing that the fun horror movie kind of playing in subversion is the high school as hell metaphor, or high school as hell tagline, where for the first 3 seasons, when the characters are in high school, like teenage anxieties are literalized as real monsters and real supernatural stuff. And I think when people say campy, that's what they think of. People think of like the silly CGI and monster makeup and the over choreographed fight scenes where you can usually tell it's a body double, a stunt double. And I think that's what people think of when they think of Buffy as camp. And I could have like recommended we watch just a bunch of like season one stuff, but I decided to pull out 4 episodes from the series for us to watch that feel like kind of standout moments of like performance and like the show's like kind of self-reflexivity. And I don't know. So the episodes were The Zeppo from season 3, Buffy versus Dracula from season 5, Storyteller from season 7. And because you can't talk about Buffy without talking about Once More with Feeling, we watch Once More with Feeling, the season 6 musical episode.
Which I found to be the most camp, I think, of all the episodes.
Yes. So I have thoughts about individual episodes, but I'd love for you to just like, I just want to hear your thoughts.
I have many thoughts.
Okay, go for it.
So in the first episode of the Seppo, I just found Xander really annoying.
I think that's a lot of people say that. A lot of people hate Xander. The Seppo is the episode I came around to him that I love Xander, so it's funny that you're just like, eh.
I feel like it was mostly just the writing. Like the writing for Xander just like couldn't help itself but to like make little jokes every second.
I mean, maybe that's, you haven't watched enough Buffy, 'cause that's, I think, the point. Is that every single character has to be witty at every single moment.
Yeah, and like that got me into thinking a lot about like Buffy speak and at large Whedon speak and like how deeply mainstream that type of writing is now.
Yeah. And now it's overdone. But at the time, I mean, at the time, it was, no one else was doing it like them. No one else was writing in that way. There's this great, it's, someone uploaded it on YouTube. It's a featurette from the season 3 DVDs that talks about Buffy speak. Watching it, they do praise Joss Whedon a lot in it. I did forget about that, which is, okay, man, that's, he's not some god. But the thing to me that I think is important about Buffy speak is, yes, a big part of it is pop culture reference, pop culture reference, pop culture reference, and not just like contemporary pop culture references, like a variety of pop culture references. You know, in the Zeppo,
the titular Zeppo is like a reference to the Marx brothers.
Yeah. And that is not something the average teenager might make a reference to, but all of the characters in Buffy have that wide breadth of knowledge. But the thing that I like about Buffy speak is when it's the turning nouns into adjectives and verbs into nouns, and there's a kind of a rhythm to it that very much feels language that I use. Going back to like what I was saying earlier about how Buffy in its writing is more than just the result of Joss Whedon, to me Buffy speak is the same way. It's more than just Joss Whedon making pop culture references. It's the writers having an understanding of the characters, and each character kind of uses different idioms and has a different pace to their language. And you can, when a character says a line, you can, out of context, you should be able to tell which character said that, because each character speaks in its own way, which I think Joss Whedon himself didn't understand. Because then you watch like The Avengers, which is something just he wrote, and it's not as good. The characters feel less each character feels like they're less distinct in their speaking patterns.
Like, that's one of the, like, big complaints of, like, the MCU and, like, larger, like, Whedon speak, is that, like, every character sounds the same.
Which is why it is so, like, that's why I'm like, everyone should watch this one featurette, or, like, because in the actual Buffy, in original, in Buffy, that's not true. Characters, there is an overall stylistic pattern to the show. There is, but it's not, there feels like there's depth to it.
It would be fun in high school to have a staff of 35-year-olds writing your dialogue, you know, because you could just be witty all the time.
And in some language, that's English.
So it feels real natural to me that Buffy and the Scooby Gang would have this kind of way of talking to one another that's very individual to them.
Each of our characters has their own distinct voice.
How come the sudden calisthenics? Aren't you sort of naturally buff?
Did you have other thoughts about the Zeppo?
I thought it, one of the, like, things that I wrote down was, like, for some reason with the Buffy episodes, I kept coming back to the sense of artificiality that comes with camp. In this episode, I noticed that, like there was this one scene that ended with Oz, like, saying something, and then his sentence just cuts to another scene, which starts with, like, an end date to the sentence that Oz started. And I just, like, thought it was, like, an interesting way to show the show's, like, sense of knowing artificiality without just the dialogue, and just, like, it was, like, the dialogue in tandem with the form of the show.
Yeah, that is something that, it was something I never noticed before. I was watching one of the video essays. I can't remember now which of the video essays it was mentioned in, but the video essayist Passion of the Nerd mentioned that a lot of, something that happens a lot in Buffy is transitions via dialogue, like dialogue match cuts. And as soon as I became aware of it, so it's all over the place in Buffy, where someone would say something and then the very next moment, the very next scene is, like, either a contradiction or an answer to the question that's posed at the end of the scene. And fun fact, that is something that happens a lot in Platoon of Power Squadron, my favorite web series. And I know for, like, I'm positive that that's directly the influence of Buffy, because I know Jake Jarvie loves that show. So is that something that you found that you enjoyed?
Yes, I definitely found it more compelling than Buffy speak.
The other reason I personally pulled, well, there's two reasons that I pulled the Zeppo out. One, it's just, I think it's an interesting Xander case study, and kind of, like, fits into our conversations about, like, masculinity, because Xander is a character who's very much throughout the show trying to struggles with toxic masculinity and like patriarchal expectations, and I feel like he is trying to perform a version of masculinity in the Zeppo until, you know, with getting the car and taking the girl out, that he by the end rejects and realizes that he has his own place. But the other reason I think the Zeppo is so interesting is one of the first times that Buffy as a show is, like, self-parodying. And I realized that that might be something that's hard to understand without the context of the rest of the show. If that's just, like, the first episode you watch, it might be like, okay, why, this feels really, like, cliche. But it's cliche on purpose, because Buffy is a show that at that point, there had been 2-3 ends of the world, you know, it's the apocalypse, it's the end of the world. And so you just have this episode where middle of the school day, it's like, it's the end of the world. And you're like, why are they, this feels so silly. And that's the point, I think.
They're being silly on purpose.
Yeah. The Passion of the Nerd, who I mentioned in his video essay on the Zeppo, he says, quote, "The Zeppo is the type of episode that makes Buffy, Buffy. It's a show that can look at its own developed cliches, point at them, and laugh, as if to say to us, you thought that was the point?" Because to me, and the Zeppo and these other episodes I pulled out are moments where the show is taking on new style, you know, being extra stylized. It's from one character's point of view. There's more, it's relying on cliches or melodrama or these one-off character, you know, episode conventions, like they have, you know, there's an alternate universe episode or the musical episode. And it does that to explore something deeper. And it has fun with it. But then when you peel back the layers, you're like, okay, take, you know, it's like Once More with Feeling. It's like, oh, there's this musical episode and there's all these choreographed dance scenes and bright colors. And then it's like, but it's a pivotal like character moment. It's it reveals these songs, reveal these like deep character anxieties and tensions, and while also being very like on the nose in its visuals and lyrics. What is it like to watch that episode without, I mean, I'm sure it's different to, from my experience, having seen the show and that episode multiple times, where I get really quite emotional watching it because it's, I care about these characters, and it's a moment where there's a lot of darkness that unfolds in that season 6. I wonder what it's like to watch that episode just examining the style in it.
Yeah, like what I mostly took away from this episode is how much it embraces artificiality and spectacle as a means of truth telling.
Snaps to that.
Yeah, I felt like this was like, of the episodes that we watched, this one was the most camp in the sense that it really committed to the musical and to how like deeply unrealistic a lot of the scenes are, just as a way to communicate truths about these characters.
It's deeply unrealistic, but also they've ground it within the mythology of the world too, which I feel like is really, it's rare to have musical that explains why everyone's suddenly singing and dancing. But in Buffy, they're like, oh, it's a demon, which makes sense within the context of the show.
But I also feel like in comparison to like other shows that have done musical episodes, I feel like one of the reasons like this episode really succeeds is like in the aforementioned commitment of it. Because I feel like a lot of other musical episodes either like half-ass it or try to make it really cool. Meanwhile, this one's like, okay, we're doing like a straightforward musical and we're gonna commit to it fully.
I have said on some occasions that my favorite musical is Once More with Feeling. And I feel like sometimes I get some looks for that, but it is a musical. It has all the acts and the arcs. Do you have a favorite song?
I know, I really like Under Your Spell.
Yeah.
Which there's layers to that one.
There are layers. There is, look, You make me complete. It's not that much of a stretch. Like, it's there. It's sung. Well, she's literally, her back is arching and in bed. The thing about Under Your Spell that I think is so interesting, that whole sequence is Willow and Tara's costumes, because, I mean, Buffy is a show that is known for its fashion, but in Once More with Feeling, it feels like a lot of the outfits people are wearing are costumes in a way that they don't, what did I write down? It feels kind of out of place in comparison to what is normally worn on the show. Like, Tara is wearing like this flowy dress and this like embroidered corset that feels both very like witchy and Disney princessy. And that definitely adds to the kind of artificiality of the whole episode.
This one's one of my least favorite songs, maybe, of the episode, but the song between Xander and Anya, like, the staging of it, I thought was really cool in the sense that it was, like, fully committed to a kind of modern version of classic musical numbers between couples.
Mm-hmm. And again, those costumes are...
like, they're clearly costumes.
Exactly. In Once More the Feeling, the dances are choreographed and with references to real, like, dance movements and eras and styles. Different dance styles that feel more, like, thoughtful or intentional than... I don't know, I've seen clips of the Riverdale musical episodes and it feels like they're just like bobbing up and down. I'm like, what is going on here?
What's going on is like them trying to make musical scenes cool instead of like completely committing to it.
Yeah. Well, musicals as a concept, it's already like a heightened sense of reality. It's an altered sense of reality. There's no way to make that cool.
And like when you try to do that, more often than not, it just ends up failing. Like you end up looking less cool when you try really hard to be a cool musical.
Can feel you inside. I'm under your spell, surging like the sea, pull to you so helplessly. I break with every swell, lost in ecstasy, spread beneath my willow tree. Make me complete.
Did you have any thoughts about Buffy versus Dracula?
I thought it was a really cool concept, like, especially considering like how much of like a vampire story icon Buffy has become. And so it really felt like a kind of like a Godzilla versus King Kong moment.
Yeah. That feels like another episode like the Zeppo that is, it's kind of playing into the self-parody, especially, or at least trying to, one of my favorite shots, honestly, in the entire series is in that episode where when Buffy is in the cemetery and is meeting Dracula, and of course is like such a fangirl about him, then... And when Willow and Xander show up, and at that point, they're, you know, it's been four years that they've known Buffy, and they're just like, Xander has like an Aloha shirt on and is like holding an iced mocha and just like strolling through a cemetery. And I love that contrast of like the bright colors and the casualness with the like dark emo brooding prince.
One of the things that I really took away from this episode is how much it reminded me that I love the juxtaposition of like summer settings with spooky stuff.
Yeah.
And like I love that they like start the episode at the beach, and then like halfway through there's like, oh, there's an old castle in Sunnydale.
I love that so much, and I almost wish that it wasn't lampshaded, because then later Riley's like, oh, I've never seen this before. I'm like, no, just embrace the fact that like, yeah, there's like 50 cemeteries in Sunnydale, and suddenly there's a castle. Like, you don't need to comment on it. It's more fun if that's just there and part of it.
Yeah, and like that's one of my like problems with Buffy speak and Whedon speak, is that like I feel like it often risks the camp by like just very overtly pointing out things.
Yeah.
Like, it's already camp, but it would have been even more camp had they just like gone along with there being a castle in Sunnydale without mention.
Yeah. Watching these episodes, do you still think it's fair to call Buffy camp?
Yes. I feel like it's kind of like on the lower end of camp, in the sense that like it often really doesn't rely on it, but it does. Like, Joss Whedon should recognize that there are camp elements in his show.
Mm-hmm. And I think individual writers are able to understand it and have more fun within like the boundaries of the show than others. Because these episodes that we watch, they kind of stand out as like specific moments where there's self-reflexivity and heightened performance. But all in all, especially as the show goes on, it becomes more serious, and it becomes like these complicated character studies. Well, I love that. I come to Buffy for the characters, and I have a good time, but the episodes that are fun and that really stand out are the episodes that are unique. I almost wish now that I had like picked out episodes like Halloween or Fear Itself, which are the Halloween episodes of Buffy. They usually are fun episodes that kind of also play around with like Halloween is an episode where on Halloween there's this one like guy who he's selling Halloween costumes, and anyone who wears his Halloween costumes on Halloween then become what they were dressed as. And like Fear Itself is an episode where it's like some frat guys have a haunted house, and then they accidentally summon a demon that makes everyone's fears like manifest and become real. And it is somewhat self-aware of like, oh, this is kind of silly, and there's some reference to it, but also they have fun with it. And like in the Halloween episode, Spike is like, this is neat. Like, and he just like is having a good time.
And like, speaking of Spike, I really appreciate that you sent a bunch of Spike clips, because there's like barely any Spike in the episodes that we watched. And I do feel like he is one of the camp elements of the show.
He is.
He's really cool, but also like failing a lot.
Yeah. So I read a really, really good article that I believe was originally published on like a like Whedon Studies blog. I can't find the original link, but I found a PDF version. It's called Queer Eye of That Vampire Guy, Spike and the Aesthetics of Camp. It's by Cynthia Mason and Marnie Stanley.
He dresses like a cartoon character in the sense that he has the one outfit.
Yes! Okay. So look. Spike is my favorite character. Spike is my favorite character on Buffy. I'm not ashamed to say that. And
from what I've seen, he's also my favorite character as well.
Part of the reason, and I couldn't pick just one episode or two episodes for you to watch to understand him as a character. I sent those compilations, which in itself, I think those videos could be studied because as like fan, like the way the fan practice of talking about Spike and pulling out his funny moments they both help reveal his complexities and also do take away some facts from like the other complicated aspects of his character, where he is a vampire, he is violent. Spike is layered and complicated, and he part of like that what you're saying is like he's acting all badass but also seems kind of pathetic comes from the fact in season 4 he gets a chip in his brain because there's this whole plot where there's like the military in Sunnydale and they're like testing on monsters. So he gets a chip in his brain where he can't hurt any humans, and it like delivers him a super painful shock, so he becomes impotent. And of course there's lots of jokes about his lack of violence being, you know, a metaphor for his lack of masculinity. But even then, Spike is always a character who performs. From the very beginning moment you see him, he has this bravado and charisma. He's incredibly stylish, like you said. He's got that one outfit that he always wears.
He's stylish with his one outfit.
And fun fact, that leather coat is a woman's coat, at least in canon.
Slay.
He took it from a slayer that he killed in the 70s, and then he wore it. But he didn't wear it. This is the thing, though. He doesn't wear it because it's like a trophy. He wears it because he likes it. And he thinks it looks good on him.
Slay.
And I mean, I don't know if it was in the compilation I sent you. There's one of my favorite moments with him. You know, he like Buffy barges into his crypt like she always does to get information and like pulls the stone cover off the crypt, you know, the crypt that he's sitting on, the coffin that he's sitting on, and pulls it out from under him. And he's like, hey, these are wet. And he's like painting his black fingernails. But on the accent. So I was talking to my friend Percival and he was like, that accent is like so like dumb. You can tell that he's American. It's like a fake accent. And I was like,
that's what makes it fun.
Yeah. The Mason and Stanley article that I read, I believe they describe it as a Mockney accent, you know, a mock Cockney accent. It's part of his performance. Another Spike thing that is fun, his crypt. You know, so there's the candles on the walls and it's all like,
yeah,
serious, except then he's also got a couch and his television where he watches soap operas.
I'm just like, he and Elvira should hang out.
If we're talking about Spike, I think he's another thing that Joss Whedon didn't understand about his own show. Because there's a James Marsters interview that I watched where, honestly, it's partially an account of another account of how toxic of a work environment Joss Whedon had, but apparently he was really upset at Marsters for being like making Spike cool, and was like, he's evil. You know, vampires are evil. Why do people like him? He's supposed to be evil. And it's like, do you not understand? He's actually like an interesting character because he defies those binaries of good and evil.
Also, what's wrong with character being fun?
Exactly. Like, it's so ironic that Buffy is a show about growing up and understanding nuance, and Joss Whedon didn't and thought that he shouldn't have nuanced antagonists.
Were you born this big a pain in the ass?
And what can I tell you, baby? I've always been bad.
Quickly. I'm the very spirit of vexation. What's another word for gleaming?
You were texting me while you were watching that you think Andrew might be your other favorite character?
I really liked Andrew from the last episode that we watched, which was Storytelling.
Storyteller.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like he mostly just felt like a breath of fresh air in terms of like his dialogue compared to everyone else's dialogue and like the way he delivers like his dialogue.
Mm.
Like it just felt like much more naturalistic and like because he like speaks really awkwardly, especially when he's like his little vlogs. But like, yeah, I was like, it's so interesting how naturalistic speech within like the Buffy speech context is camp.
Oh, that's a fun way. I never thought about it that way. Storyteller as an episode is so interesting because there's this kind of reoccurring theme in Buffy of these performances, of these kind of, you know, either episodes are from specific characters' point of view, but in Storyteller, you actively see Andrew constructing that. You see his, you know, the opening is him sitting in an armchair and fancy fireplace, and then you get the knock and you cut to and you see him with his camcorder and you realize that it's a performance, which I think is really fun. And it almost feels kind of this like this evolution of the show to have in its final season.
I think even from like the very beginning of the episode, it very much felt like a performance because like most of the, like the only other time in which we saw like characters speak directly to camera was in Once More with Feeling, and that's because they're in a musical.
Yeah. But I think it's fun that we get to see how that performance is constructed with the camera. And then like talking about Spike too, going a bit back to that, is that in Storyteller, we see there's that, like, it's such a small scene that I had forgotten about.
I took note of that scene. That's like one of the scenes that I took a note of.
Where Spike's like, you know, you see him and he's like, I told you to stop filming me. And then you hear Andrew behind the camera being like, Spike, there the light was behind you. And Spike's like, oh, okay. And then like does it again. Like you know as a viewer that Spike is putting on a kind of a performance throughout his character because you see moments of his vulnerability, but it's also so fun to see him like actively constructing that with Andrew.
I like did take note of that because it was like another instance of like knowing artificiality without it being like directly like referenced within dialogue. It was just simply the performance in combination with like something he says to another character.
Yeah. And I do think also like Andrew and his relation to performance and his relation to camp in this episode, it feels important to bring up how queer coded he is.
Yeah, because like when I texted you, I was like, I really like this queer coded character.
Yeah,
because I couldn't remember his name. But I was like, what's another good descriptor for this character so Saffron knows who I'm talking about?
and I mean, it's not even like, it feels like barely like subtext even. It's never said that Andrew is gay, but there are multiple references to him being in love with Warren, who was his best friend, but also Warren was not a gray guy at all. And I mean, and then Storyteller, there's that scene where he's watching the videotape of Xander and Anya, and he's mouthing along to Anya's lines and then like watching it back, and like so that he can like hear what Xander says to him, you know, over and over again. Tom Link, the actor who plays Andrew, is gay. And apparently in the comics, because there are the story of Buffy continues on in a Dark Horse Comics run, Andrew does come out as gay in the comics. I guess I feel complicated about the fact that it's like, okay, yes, Andrew feels gay, and it's honestly, it's there in the text, like that he has feelings for men. So I don't feel like it's necessary for him to come out, but at the same time, I do wish that it was in like the canon of the show, if it wasn't in the canon of the show,
yeah.
because less people are going to read it, that means less people are going to know about it. And it's yeah. always nice to have it said aloud, you know, or at least shown.
For God's sakes, Andrew, you've been in here for 30 minutes. What are you doing?
Entertaining and educating.
Why can't you just masturbate like the rest of us?
I could talk about Buffy for forever. I don't have, I guess, any more specific thoughts related to camp and how Buffy is camp. I can scroll through my notes, but I mean, do you have any like questions or thoughts that you still have?
I don't know. I was wondering if you had any questions for me.
I mean, my questions have mainly been like, did you like it? Did you enjoy it? Did you would you watch more of it?
I did, like, I've already seen it a few times, but I do like Once More with Feeling, and the Dracula episode was fun.
But you probably don't have enough like emotional attachment to the characters to want to sit down and watch 7 seasons.
No.
That's fair. Maybe I'll just give you the list of the best Spike episodes and you could watch those. Cause I could give you a full list of Spike episodes, and honestly you could probably just watch that and like have a good time. Were your just questions, what was I thinking? Do you have like specific, you know, thought, like are you at all curious about like the lore of Buffy, the appeal of Buffy, or
like I do get the appeal. Like I'm just mostly like Buffy speak really backfired on us as a society.
You're really hung up on that, huh?
Yeah.
That's so interesting, because for me, I think the thing that I feel like society and academics got hung up on was Buffy as like the ideal representation for female characters in television. Because I love Buffy. I think she's a fascinating character, and it is, for a long time, it was quite rare to see teenage girlhood in television and see a young woman grow up. But Buffy is still, she is a specific kind of girlhood.
Yeah.
She is a white middle-class girlhood. And there is queer representation on Buffy. Willow comes out as gay and gets a girlfriend, but the show is so white. It's so white. I say that as a white person. Its depiction of, I mean, its treatment of BIPOC, it's not great. I went to so many panels at conventions that would talk about Buffy, and everyone would be like, can you think of another example besides Buffy? And people would be like, well, there's this character, but they're like adults. And now, I think the last couple years, we've had more shows. We've had a more of a diverse selection of interesting teenage girlhood. I mean, I've yet to cross them off my watch list, but Yellow Jackets and The Wilds, First Kill, which is coming out when we're recording this. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a show worth talking about. And obviously in this context of camp, it's super fun.
Yeah, like I think the iconography of Buffy Summers is really cool.
Yeah.
Like the image of her like fighting vampires is just a really cool, like instant character iconography.
But like, yeah, we're never gonna lose that influence that this character will have on pop culture. And I love her and I'm grateful for that. I'm also so excited to see what future shows and what contemporary shows are going to do with playing with new kinds of female archetypes. And hopefully there are some that are that embrace the camp and embrace are commit to kind of the ridiculousness and the exaggeration of the kind of characters they are. How does that feel like a place to end?
Yeah, that feels like a really good ending spot, a good end note.
Okay. Well, that's it for this episode of It's Giving Camp. You can find us on Twitter at Giving Camp Pod
and on Instagram at It's Giving Camp Pod.
And that's all lowercase, one word. Our theme music that you are listening to right now is by Harrison Murray. I'm Saffron Heftigal. I'm online at Gal Hefta.
And I'm Fabiola Liano, and you can find me on Twitter at Fabiola_Liano.
Thank you so much for listening. And if you enjoy our podcast, please recommend it to your friends and give us a rating online.